We often sing the song, "Let Us Break Bread Together." That song evokes feelings of closeness, fellowship, a sharing, not only of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, but of our life together. And the fact is, we were designed to walk together. Dr. M.A.C. Warren writes regarding the origins of a growth in Christianity in East Africa that there was a deep hunger for human fellowship of the kind which would be an effective demonstration of the power of God to establish right human relationships. Now, I believe that this point demands attention. There is, of course, one sense in which joy, gregariousness is a commonplace of most religious movements. But there was something more than just that. Our generation has seen the disintegration of so many traditional patterns of human life, has seen so many ancient unities destroyed, that it is to be expected that a search for a new unity should be one of the marked characteristics of our time. Man, isolated, alone, and afraid, knows that it is not good for him to be by himself. Now, here's the amazing thing about this. It was written in 1954. Imagine what Max Warren would say if he were looking at society today. Bow your heads with me. Almighty God, you have called your church to witness that in Christ you have reconciled us to yourself. Grant that by your Holy Spirit we may proclaim the good news of your salvation so that all who hear it may receive the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. Now, sometimes you can be so deep into a conversation, you don't even notice what's going on around you. How many of you all have had that experience, huh? Yeah. Especially when that subject is something that has tremendous consequences, especially when those consequences look bleak, as they did for these two disciples of Jesus. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there these days?" He said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty indeed in word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened." Now, Jesus had told the disciples he would be crucified and rise again the third day. The disciples could not deny that everything that had happened lined up exactly with what Jesus had taught them, right up to the strange reports that they were about to relate to this stranger. Verse 22, "Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. There's a thin but decisive line between believing that Jesus is a gifted, charismatic messenger of God and believing that he is God with us, our Savior. And many of his friends and followers came right up to that line, but would not cross over it. Even early church leaders noticed a telling distinction in Martha's words to our Lord at Lazarus's tomb. It's found in the Concordia commentary on the Gospel of John. Theophylact sees the problem exactly. Martha had faith toward Christ, but not as much as she ought. Therefore, she says, "Lord, had you been here, my brother would not have died." And she said this rightly enough, yet as one not believing that were he absent, he would be able, even if he willed, to turn death away from her brother. And in what follows, she displays a greater weakness of faith. She says, "Whatsoever you should ask of God, he will give to you." Do you see that she regarded him as a certain virtuous man and one held in honor before God? For she did not say, "Whatsoever you should will, you shall do," but "Whatever you should ask, he will give." The history of Israel was the history of men whom God had used mightily, but who were all defeated by death. Only Elijah the prophet, the Tishbite, managed to avoid the sting of death. At best, these two men had hoped that Jesus would, like Elijah, not be taken away by death and would bring in the kingdom of God, which he proclaimed and taught about. They had hoped for a miraculous intervention by God that would have brought the plans of Jesus' enemies to nothing. The strange reports of the women, the admittedly empty tomb where Jesus' body had been hastily placed before the Sabbath, did not silence the despairing claim by death to have conquered even the one who could arrest death and snatch back those who had been imprisoned by hell. It was too much for them to trust in the Lord and in his word, this exceeding great promise that in 3 days he would rise again. These two men poured out their anguish to this stranger. Incredulous, he did not know about the reason for their sorrow, their loss of hope. But he said to them, "Foolish ones, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is now far spent." So he went in to stay with them. But still, even with this sermon, drawing them through the history of Israel, the prophetic teachings of Moses and the prophets, all confirming the word that Jesus had spoken about these events, although they were hearing, they could not see. Yet one thing remained to turn their despair into joy. Verse 30. When he was at table with them, he took the bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." And then they told what had happened on the road, how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Note Ecclesiae, Latin for notes of the church, are found in the Nicene Creed. Are the church as one holy, Catholic, and apostolic, or unity, holiness, Catholicity, and apostolicity. Protestant reformers emphasized the marks as preaching the word and right administration of the sacraments. Now, not either alone, but both together mark where God's people are gathered together in worship and in adoration of their Lord and Savior. His will is declared to us in the preaching of the gospel, and he is made known to us in baptism and Holy Communion. The table of the Lord confirms the promises declared in the preached word of the Lord and entered into at the baptismal font, the gifts of forgiveness and fellowship. They are made tangible to us as we eat this bread and drink this cup. As Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 11:26, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Everything that the bride of Christ does in worship and ministry has this purpose: to deliver the gifts of God to the people of God and to declare the faithfulness of God to the world, that it might come to know him as their Lord and Savior. Everything that we do leads us to this divine service. Everything that we do as his witnesses flows from this divine sacrifice. Service, rather. He meets us here at the pulpit and the altar, and so sacred is this tent of fellowship that we dare not share it with those who do not receive it as the church has administered it faithfully for over 2,000 years. The presence of the Lord is not a wish, nor is it something that only exists by our declaration, our singing, or our shouting. It exists because our Lord Jesus Christ opened our eyes to see him as he unites us to himself in holy baptism and gives us his body to eat and his blood to drink for the forgiveness of sins in Holy Communion. Here, the promises of the gospel are delivered. Here, the forgiveness of sins are received. And here, the cleansing of his bride takes place. From Ephesians chapter 5, beginning at verse 26, Paul wrote that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. And 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning at verse 16, "The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread." The ministry of word and sacrament defines us as much as our liturgy, as much as our hymnody. For they all serve the one purpose of making him known and distributing his gifts that he has given us stewardship. Those who dismiss them, regardless of what else they may do that we share in common with them, marks them out, in the words of Dr. Martin Luther to Ulrich Zwingli and his colleagues at the Colloquy of Marburg, "You have a different spirit from ours." We cling to God's promises. Let the world do what it will, and let others who claim to preach the gospel say about them. The promises of God in Christ are as real today as they were on the road to Emmaus, and they bless us today as surely as they did on that evening when he was known to them in the breaking of bread. So we pray for the unity of the church, not only culturally, politically, and socially, although those are good, right, and salutary reasons to pray, but especially in pulpit and altar, word and sacrament, we pray, "Let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." We pray this because in truth, we are one body We do partake of the one loaf. We do drink of the one cup, the cup of blessing. But the Bible tells us to make sure that we do so worthily, that we do so recognizing the Lord's body and blood. And so we pray for our brothers and sisters that they would come to the knowledge of the truth. We pray for those who are hungering and thirsting for righteousness, that they would come and be filled. We pray for those who don't know the forgiveness of sins, that they would come and hear the good news and be united to Christ and eat that bread and drink that cup. For as long as we do, we proclaim his death. Until he comes, we proclaim two things. We proclaim that he died for us, for his children, for his people, for the world. He died for all of us. And then, as we do that, we remember that his death redeemed us. His death purchased our redemption, purchased our fellowship with the Father, purchased our fellowship with one another. It delivered us from every evil and granted us peace in our days. The shed blood of Jesus and the peace of God that passes understanding, let it guard your hearts and minds. Through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.